Hi, welcome to this lecture about ethics and informed consent. It's one out of eight lectures in a course on qualitative methods in general, and you can see the names of the seven other lectures on this slide. But the learning objectives for this lecture are to get more insight into why ethics and informed consent are important. Well, we all know that we need to apply to science ethics committees or report projects to data protection committees. But why is it so important? So, we also explore what ethical issues need to be considered when planning and carrying out qualitative research. And one of the aims is also to be able to discuss and reflect about ethics in qualitative research. Because when it comes to ethics, reflection is important and final answers are rare. We can talk about this as from Hippocrates to Helsinki and beyond. Many people, at least in the healthcare professions, know this sentence, primum nil nocere, first do no harm. That's said to stem from Hippocrates. And Hippocrates laid the ethics basis for the physician's work and for physician research by the oath. He wrote approximately 430 before Christus. So already there are the principles. So ethics considerations in medicine are nothing new, luckily. Then there came World War II, and physicians, German physicians, were somehow led to do things that maybe were not that good from ethical point of view, and they were taken to court in Nuremberg in August 1947, and 23 German physicians were got the verdict of being guilty of war crimes and crimes against humanity, guilty of reckless experiments on human subjects, among other prisoners and disabled. And the trial led to the Nuremberg Code or Codex, consisting of 10 principles, and I am not going to read out those principles. You can look them up in writing. And then in 1964, the World Medical Association published the Helsinki Declaration, where it's very much emphasized that the patient's or the volunteer's interests come first, and research interests or needs only after the patient's interests. And these things led to establishment of data protection committees and the science ethics committees that everyone knows are a large part of doing research today. Ethics in qualitative research, what to keep in mind? Well, all general ethics issues in research should of course be looked into, but specifically, there's, for example, the use of quotations. How do you use quotations to be, for example, to be certain that the informant is not recognized by the wording? But the words he or she uses. What information do you give to observed or interviewed people? You should give sufficient information to them about the project to make it transparent to them what you're doing, but not so much information that it starts to influence what they say to you. And this might be a delicate balance. Well, what evidence is there of the research having taken place? Could the researcher have invented the interviews, for example? How do you go about respecting promises of anonymity? Sometimes you are doing research on very small groups, very identifiable groups. If you, for example, go into a small village in Iceland and later publish something on it, everyone in the village will know who the informants are. So you may have to take some measures to sort of hide the identity of the informant. When do you hide identity to such an extent that it influences the outcome of the research? Is it okay to change gender? If it later turns out that the gender might be an important issue? That's sometimes done in order to hide the identity of the informant. Researched relationship. Sometimes you know your subjects, and sometimes you get to know your subjects. Sometimes friendship potential can arise from originally a research project. How do you handle that? People in vulnerable contexts. I'll give an example of, for example, doing research in a public toilet. It has been done. Audio recording, is that okay? Do the informants feel it's okay? Does it change the contents of the interview? What about video filming? Video filming is more controversial than audio recording. What about use of photographs? People are identifiable in photographs. There are different challenges in different methods. For example, internet research. Would it be okay to take a Facebook discussion group and analyze the contents of that? Would it be okay to analyze the contents of an anonymous chat forum on the internet? If you're going to analyze the contents of an anonymous chat forum on the internet, would it be necessary to tell the subjects or the people who are discussing there that you're a researcher, observing what they're talking about? Do you need to do that? Or is it okay just to go ahead and analyze? Now we're into covert research. Action research. To what extent can you analyze your own environment, so to speak? To what extent can you do research in your own surroundings? Are you neutral there? Is it necessary to be neutral, or is it sufficient to be aware of own preconceptions? What about field work? You might become very much friends with the subjects. You might become a part of the field, go native, or you might never understand the field you're researching. Would you, as a researcher, for example, be able ever to understand what it's like to be in a prison? When you, as opposed to the prisoners, can go out wherever you like whenever you like. In-depth interviewing, I'm not going to dwell on that. That's probably the most discussed method of qualitative research. So there's a lot to read in the literature about ethical aspects of that. But for example, getting an informed consent there from maybe subjects that you've talked about or talked to several times before, does it feel natural to get them to sign a written consent? Are there other better ways to do it? Focus groups. Would it be necessary to ask everyone in the focus group to sign a consent to not telling what was discussed in the group? Or because the participants in a focus group, they can say whatever they like about having participated in a focus group, unless you ask them to sign something. And if you ask them to sign something, well, they could still talk about it. If you want to read more about the essentials of thinking ethically in qualitative research, then there is this book by Routledge, published in 2013. It touches upon both different research methods and different aspects of doing qualitative research. Like, there's a specific chapter on qualitative research in healthcare. If you want to look into cases, there is this case of Carlos Castaneda, the teachings of Don Juan. And after that book was published, it has been heavily discussed. How was the research undertaken? And actually, the question, was the research undertaken, has been discussed. Then there is Lord Humphreys' Tea Room Trade. And there is a number of ethical issues there that initially seem to go unnoticed. Lord Humphreys went into public toilets for men and observed what was going on there. And there were things going on that many women would probably have a hard time imagining. Lord Humphreys did not tell the men who went in and out of these toilets that he was doing research there. And he did not tell either until many years later that he was homosexual himself. Hannes Hólmsteinn Gissurarson, professor at the University of Iceland, wrote three books about our Nobel laureate, the Icelandic Nobel Prize winner Halldór Laxness. He won the Nobel Prize in Literature. And Hannes Hólmsteinn used some texts by Laxness without putting them into quotation marks and without putting a reference on them. So the summary here is that ethical issues arise in qualitative research just as in quantitative, and maybe even more, that gray zones exist, that rules, regulations, and guidelines do not safeguard against these gray zones. You have to be able to reflect that the researcher always needs to explore the ethical aspects thoroughly. And that general ethical issues need to be thought through, both general ethical issues in healthcare research, in research on humans, and in research with limits to transparency. Here are a few references, some of them with links, but the book does not have a link because it's not available free of charge on the internet, but you can buy it if you want to. Thank you.